everything to Him. We just need to always keep that on our hearts. Alright, maybe it's you.
Yeah, we do owe all to Him. Absolutely. Last weekend, we had a very busy weekend, amen? Had a lot of activities, and I know all the young people had a lot of candy. Some of us did, too. We're all young at heart, though, right? Well, this is the week following the resurrection. This is the week following Jesus conquering the tomb. And we're going to look at how the disciples handled that in a little while. I have a video for you very quickly. A lot of people, we've heard, you know, a lot of people know that they need to go to church, and a lot of people looking for churches, and people shopping around, if you will. So I have a little video to illustrate that.
Do we have to do this today? Can we wait and come back next week?
No, I know you. If we wait until next weekend, it'll be like 6 months before I even get you this far again. Okay. Let's go in.
Fine. What are you waiting for?
I hate the way they stand there and wait for you to come in.
Yes, and the big handshake, and they greet you like they've known you forever.
We've saved a seat for you!
How long have you been looking? Where else have you gone?
We've got something special for the kiddies today. We're gonna give them lots of candy and things that make a joyous noise!
You know, I like the guy we had a few weeks ago.
What guy? I don't remember.
The guy with the jeans.
Oh, and all the tattoos? No!
Oh, come on, I felt a connection with him. It felt like he knew exactly why I was there.
That guy went on forever. I thought he would never finish.
See, I was okay with him until he got to the part about the money. I mean, it's always about the money.
Honey, we are not alone.
Right. Sorry.
That's why we're here. All right, let's try one more time. Let's do it for the kids.
For the kids. We're here now anyway, so we may as well go in for our free cup of coffee.
What were you expecting? You know, that's how you feel every time you go out to get a car. Come on. Or a church. That's what it said at the end of it. Are you a consumer or are you a disciple? And unfortunately, a lot of people shop around for a church. You know, I've had a lot of people that have told me, at Beulah, they've come and they hadn't come back. And I'd give them a call if I happened to see them, happened to run into them or something. And well, we're going over to this other one. You know, they have a youth program. They have a child, you know, kid program and things. And I told them, I said, well, we have that too, but we need children to do that with. We have to have young people. And if everyone takes their young people away, you know, I've got a young couple here sitting here doing nothing. And so we need to utilize these guys, you know, and it's like everything else, you know. I go in certain places, and Miranda goes in certain places, you know, and we try to cast a wide net, but our nets seem to have a lot of holes in them. So we need a lot of help. just in inviting people, getting people to come. And like I mentioned earlier, this is the week following Easter, the week following the resurrection. And what is it, how is it that, how did the disciples handle that? What did they do? More than likely, most of you sitting here going, well, they went fishing. We're not talking about fishing today. All right, you guys remember that? The Apostle Peter? He says, wow, I'm going fishing. And they all said, that sounds like a good idea. Well, in the Gospel according to Mark, following a time after the resurrection, we want to look at Mark chapter 16, the very last chapter of the Gospel of Mark, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Matthew, Mark, second book of the New Testament. And following a time, and the text coming from verse 14, but I want to open with verse 9 of Mark chapter 16, and we'll read down through verse 13. And as always, we ask if you're able to stand in the honor of the reading of the Lord's word. Mark chapter 16, beginning in verse 9 of Mark 16, and the word of the Lord says, now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. And she went and told them that had been with him, as they mourned and wept. And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. After that, he appeared in another form unto two of them, as they walked and went into the country. And they went and told it unto the residue, neither believed they them. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, many have been told this past week that the tomb is empty, that you're alive, that you have risen. And now at this very moment, Lord, we know that you're at the right hand of the Father. Many people have heard these words and still do not believe. And Lord, many of us from time to time, we may grow tired or in cold and then indifferent, do our daily struggles and things that as we're going along. Lord, we need to be reminded over and over and over again to strengthen us and to encourage us. And Lord, that's our prayer at this very moment. We ask for your hand of strengthening and hand of encouragement. But again, Lord, I thank you for each one. I thank you for all who are hearing, all those who are watching, and all those who will. And may your words truly and clearly be proclaimed. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Have a seat. We see here how Mary, when Jesus appeared to her, she went and told, and they didn't believe. When the two disciples were going to a city called Emmaus, and they met a man on the road, and during their conversation, they realized that it was Jesus to whom they were speaking. They went back immediately and told, as Mark terms it, the residue, those who were there, those who were hiding away in the upper room, those who had not at that moment seen, they still didn't believe. And in verse 14 of Mark chapter 16, afterwards, after these that we just mentioned, after him appearing to some and they going back and telling their testimony, their witness, I've seen Jesus, I've seen him, I've talked with him, I know he's alive. Those others did not believe. And so in verse 14, afterwards, he, Jesus, appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. Jesus comes and corrects these disciples. Corrects them. And you'll notice there the word upbraided them. We do not like to be corrected, do we? I don't know about you, But I've been reprimanded. And when I became a first sergeant, I reprimanded. And it's not a fun time. You know, it's like we hear and we ourselves have experienced as children, you know, our mother or father is going to hurt me more than you. And we didn't believe them at the time until it happens to us. Well, that's true. Jesus confronts his disciples. And he gets in their face, so to speak. He upbraided them. He became rather upset that his disciples, and it talks about the 11 in particular, the apostles, at this moment Judas has gone from them. He hung himself. So he's talking mainly at this particular verse to the apostles, because it speaks of the 11. But there were others, I believe, in the room as well. And confronting the people who should have believed immediately because of his word to them, his testimony while he was alive, and they seeing the arrest, they seeing Jesus being carried away, the Apostle John being with Jesus during the entire situation, the Apostle Peter following at a distance but still following, and all of them, while he is being crucified, standing afar off, save John, seeing it, being witness to his burial, but at the same time witnessing his burial and the stone being placed in front of it and the seal being and the soldiers being placed, experiencing all this and then having such fear for themselves and hiding away. And for some reason, forgetting that the words that Jesus has spoke. Because they weren't concerned about Jesus, per se. They were concerned about themselves. Being arrested, being carried away. What do we do now? Where do we go from here? And Jesus corrected them, and he got rather upset because of their unbelief. Upbraided them, reprimanded them with their unbelief and hardness of heart. Their unbelief. In Luke chapter 24, verses 25 and 26, then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken, ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? You see, the disciples, as all the other Jews, believed that Jesus was going to assume to be their king at that moment in the flesh and drive out the Romans and take care of them and establish his kingdom. And when that didn't happen, when he allowed himself to be arrested, when he allowed himself to be beaten, when he allowed himself to be crucified, and he died, we thought he was the Messiah. We thought he was going to come back and save us. What do we do now? Apparently, they weren't really listening to Jesus, save John. And in John chapter 20, verses 26 and 27, and after 8 days again, his disciples were within and Thomas with them. Remember Thomas, the apostle Thomas? Then came Jesus, the door being shut, and stood in the midst of them, and said, Peace be unto you. Then saith he to Thomas, singling out Thomas, because remember, the others had seen Jesus, and Thomas wasn't with them. I won't believe unless I put my fingers in the nail holes and my hand in his side. I have to reach out and touch him. So Jesus here in John chapter 20, verse 26 and 27, Peace be unto thee, then saith to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And he does believe. After that moment, he believes. Now Jesus again, he reprimands Thomas. He's not believing the witness, the testimony of the others. Why not? When you go and tell someone about Jesus and what Jesus is doing to help you and strengthen you and encourage you, that you have, if you will, witnessed the saving grace of Jesus, and they turn away, how do you feel? How do you feel? You truly telling them, expressing to them your desire. Look, I know who Jesus is, and he's my personal Lord and Savior, and I'm going to tell you about that. I don't have time. I don't believe. Now, hopefully it hurts your heart. It hurts Jesus when his disciples didn't believe. The people he was actually with. And there are times like that in our lives, quite honestly, when we can become rather distant from God. We allow circumstance, we allow relationship, we allow a lot of things to get in the way of our personal walk with Christ. And then we start doubting. We start having problems. And that's what's happening here. And so he's correcting them over their unbelief, their hardness of heart. And that's really the issue that can come upon us. We allow our faith to become thin, and then our hearts become hardened. And that's what he's correcting them, because of their hard hearts. In Hebrews 3, verses 12 and 13, take heed, brethren, lest there be any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily. Pray for one another. Encourage one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Proverbs 28:14, happy is the man that feareth always, but he that hardeneth his heart shall fall into mischief. I love the way they just translate that, into mischief. And then John 8:24, I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins, for if ye believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. We have to believe that Jesus is who he says he is. We have to know that. We have to believe that deep within ourselves. Because if we don't, we'll start drifting. And we'll start having hardness of heart. And the verse clearly tells us, Jesus appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat. They're having dinner. And he upbraided them. And he upbraided them because of their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. So when a brother or sister in Christ comes to us with a concern, have we been with Jesus? Have they? They may have a concern for themselves, but they also may have a concern for you. So we have to receive that. We have to believe that. Jesus is really, in Scripture in general, a lot of times people are not calmly and lovingly expressed to. A lot of times. I mentioned the prophet that went to before King David and told him that wonderful story about the poor man who had a lamb that he treated as a child or as a son or a daughter, and the rich man who came and had a friend come and he wanted to give a banquet to him, and so he went and took the poor man's lamb and roasted it. And when the prophet told King David that, King David got a little upset, didn't he? He did. He got, that's mad. We're going to have this guy. And the prophet stood there and says, you're that man. You're that man. That's bold. To me, that's one of the most dramatic, next to the resurrection, the crucifixion. That's a very dramatic scene. You have to understand that. Jesus is not going to his disciples here very calmly. Says, hey, you guys need to wake up a little bit, you know. He's getting in their face. He's upset with them. I mean, to upbraid them. I mean, he's getting real. And we need that, unfortunately, so many times. But we don't like to hear it. What was it that Jesus was trying to get these guys to do? What is it he's trying to tell these people? To wake them up to do it. He's commissioned them. We lovingly call that the Great Commission. And in verses 15 and 16, and he, Jesus, he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. All right. So where are they supposed to do this? See, he's getting on to them in verse 14 because they're not doing what he's told them to do. He's telling his church to be active, to be involved, to be doing things for him that he has commissioned them to do. What are they doing? They're sitting around having fellowship. They're eating fried chicken. It doesn't say that, but we know they're good Baptists, so. They were sitting around having a meal. They weren't doing what he told them to do, so he got upset with them. He'd get upset with us. Because he's commissioned them, he's commissioned us. Where are they supposed to do it? In all the world. Everywhere they go. I render in Matthew chapter 28, go ye therefore, as in here, to me, as you're going. You're living your life. We want to look at it and say, well, no, he's telling that missionary as he's going to Africa. He's telling that missionary as he's going to India. No, he's telling us as we're going to Walmart. Go ye therefore in the whole world. I assure you, Walmart is an active missionary field. Whew. Man. You know, they get free advertising about every week from me. I have to talk to him about that. But I don't want Jesus upset with us. But I'm concerned that he is. There's a wonderful depiction of as you're going, as the Apostle Paul was on Mars Hill. And he started talking to the people there. Because as he was walking down the road, there were statues to all these different gods, to Venus and Jupiter and all this stuff. And then there was one that was there, and it says, to the unknown God. Because they didn't want to leave anybody out. But we don't want to offend any of them. And he used that opportunity as a witnessing tool. And he says, I want to tell you about that one. The one that you're not aware of. I want to tell you about God. I want to tell you about Jesus. He told him about the resurrection, the crucifixion, the resurrection. He told him about that. And that intrigued some of them. Not all of them, but it intrigued some of them. And so he used that opportunity, and we can use that opportunity as well. No matter where we're going, what we're doing, but we need to be willing to do it. What is it that they were to do? Well, the gospel. Go into the whole world and preach the gospel. What is the gospel? The good news. That's what the word gospel means, is good news. And what's the good news? Jesus Christ. Amen. That's the good news. When we talk about in the New Testament, the first four books of the New Testament, the Gospels, the good news, that's Jesus. That's who we're supposed to talk to. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning in verse 1, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. I can't give you something that I haven't received. How that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. That's the gospel. That's it. And that's what we're to tell people. I want to tell you about a man that I met, a homeless man. Amen? We're saved by a homeless man. I want to tell you about a guy that I met. The Apostle Paul talked about a man he met on the road to Damascus. I tell you about a man I met in the bottom of a refrigerator freezer. Wherever you met him, And I want to tell you that he's my Lord and Savior. I know that he walked this earth. He taught the people. He was arrested. He was crucified. He died. He was buried. And on the third day, he rose again and is right hand of the Father. How do you know that? I know that.
Amen.
How many people here know who the 16th president of the United States was? Abraham Lincoln. How do you know that? How do you know that? Read in a book. Anybody here vote for Abraham Lincoln? I'm not saying you wouldn't, but you didn't. We're not that old, right? But we know that Abraham Lincoln was the 16th president of the United States. How do I know that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior? I read it in a book. I walked it. I believed it. I accepted it. I know this truthfully within myself. I have no doubt. I don't. I've walked it out. We're to tell people the gospel. And why do we do it? So they will receive salvation. Jesus never mentioned that there was never difficulty in doing what he's asked us to do. He says, in this life you will have tribulation. He says, but be of joy. I've overcome the world. It's going to be difficult from time to time. It's going to be lonely. It's going to be difficult in that people don't want to hear it. These 11 men didn't want to hear it either. But they had to. If he hadn't have told them, and in that way, to wake them up, to do it, they probably never would have done it. It would have been a lot easier to go back fishing. I assure you. It's a lot easier to do nothing than to do something. And people say, well, I don't want to do it because somebody criticized me. They absolutely will. No question about it. Someone will complain about it. Because you're doing it. In Romans 6, verse 6 and 7, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin, for he that is dead is freed from sin. That's how it is. The old man is crucified. The old person, our old self. The Apostle Paul says that I was crucified with Christ, and yet I live. But not I who live, but he who lives within me. That's who's alive today, and that's Jesus. I'm not saying I am he any more than you are he, but he is within each and every one of us through the Holy Spirit, equipping us and helping us. And so what's the result if someone refuses? Latter part of verse 16. But he that believeth not shall be damned. In John 3:19, and this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. We wind up in certain situations in our life, and we just become comfortable with them. We're just easy with it. It's because it becomes second nature. We're just comfortable with our life. We get up every day, think the same things, do the same things, go through the same situations. I mean, I'm one of those bad guys. I have to turn the lights. I have to be in a certain position when I leave a room. It has to be down, not up, kind of thing, you know. I call it a monkism. So. An old TV show called Monk. He had to have that. Every one of us have something like that. Some worse than others. But in Romans 5:12, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, who was that? Adam. And death by sin. And so death passes upon all men, for that all have sinned. Every one of us are sinners. There are a lot of things that this nation, this society is allowing to go on and kind of winking at, if you will. Allowing to happen. Well, if we pass a law, then you have to obey it. Man can pass all the laws they want to, But when they're in contradiction to the Word of God, they're wrong. It's a sin. It is a sin. But people wind up in certain situations of life, and it's just habit. Get comfortable with it. This is the way I am. Not the way you have to stay. And so that's what he's upbraiding the disciples, because they're not doing it. They need to go out and they teach this and they tell people this. And if that's what we're to do, and it's up to the person receiving it, what they do with it. It's like if you had the ability to go up to someone and hand them a $100 bill, here, I want to give you this $100. What they do with that $100 is up to them, not you. Here's a free gift. Here's $100. You say, I'm going to give you this $100, but I want you to go do this and this and this. Well, why don't you go do this, this, and this with it? You're giving it to me, I can do what I want to with it. I give you the free gift of salvation. Here's the gospel. I'll present it to you. What you do with it is up to you. Can't force it down anybody. But they were contracted in verse 17 and 18, and these signs shall follow them that believe. Now, wouldn't it be great if we could do these things today? All but one of them. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In thy name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. I like that latter part. Not the other part. I didn't do that. Remember, when these disciples were going out, they did not have this. They didn't have that. They were, in essence, writing that. I mean, they didn't have that. Jesus used these miracles that he did to declare who he was. You know, the wonderful scene, and I repeat this nearly every week, where they lowered a friend down through the roof in front of Jesus, and he tells him, first, your sins are forgiven you. All the people around him, thinking within themselves, who do you think he is? He's not God. He can't forgive sins. Jesus knew that that's what they were thinking. How do you know that? Because he is God. He has the authority. And he told them that. And he says, look, what's easier, to say his sins are forgiven or to tell him to get up and walk? I'll lay it to you. But to tell you and show you that I have the authority to forgive his sins, get up and walk. Take up your bed and go home. And he did. Immediately. Then he got in trouble for carrying his bed on the Sabbath, but then it's a different story. A bunch of religious people. But they were contracted, and they had this ability to go out and do that. I know missionaries would love to have just instantly know the language. Signs shall follow them. In thy names cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. I got in a heavy discussion with some guy one time about this tongue thing, and I don't believe that I could stand here and just start spouting out two syllable words, and you wouldn't understand it. There wouldn't be any communication. Quite honestly, I do not believe when we get to heaven we will be speaking English or Spanish or Italian. You know, I'm sure that they have a language in heaven. I don't know what that is. And I don't believe anybody that starts spouting that stuff off is saying it. I mean, why is it only two syllables? I don't understand. I think God has a bigger vocabulary than that. However, I don't know what that is. I'll find out one day soon. They shall take up serpents. Nah, we're not going there. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. Now, the Apostle Paul, when he was shipwrecked and had the snake bite him, he just shook it off. There you go. And these people, they were waiting for him to die. They knew the snake. You know, he got bit. He must be a bad guy. He didn't drown, so God's going to kill him now. And he didn't die, so they wanted to know why. And so it gives credence to their gospel, their testimony that they're saying. We have the Word of God. But when that which is perfect has come, and that's the Bible, these things shall be done away with, 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Okay? All I'm proclaiming to you is the words that are here, the words that you have before you, that people have died for you to read in English, by the way. In Acts chapter 1, beginning verse 6, when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he, Jesus, said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, in Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Now, we're real big on trying to get people to go to the uttermost parts of the earth, but we're kind of unwilling to just go next door. And we shouldn't do that. If we're willing to send somebody out, and then we'll be praying for people to surrender to ministry until it's our children. Time out. I didn't mean that. God has a plan for everybody. And he's confirmed it. Verse 19 and 20 of Mark chapter 16. So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. So the Lord's ascension, he's at the position of power, the right hand of God. In Philippians 3, verse 20 and 21, for our conversation is in heaven, from which also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. He has that power. He has that power. And we have the Holy Spirit after the Lord has spoken. And he received up, right? Well, we know how the Holy Spirit come upon them and it empowered them. Verse 20, and they went forth and preached everywhere the Lord Jesus. I want you to notice there in verse 20 that one phrase, the Lord working with them. The Lord working with them. How is he able to do that? Because of the Holy Spirit that resides within each and every one of us. The Lord is working with us. He's working through us. He's helping us, strengthening us. He's empowering us. And our empowerment doesn't necessarily come from being able to speak Spanish fluently with never having any lessons, waking up in the morning, well, I know how to speak Spanish. That would be a blessing, amen? Absolutely, especially here. However, we have to work at that. And what God does is empower us to birth this vision within us to do it. It's like Brother Brandon is expanding the pad out there. He has a vision for enlargement, enlarging the ministry. And we need to buy into that vision that he has. What about us? Do we have a vision? Are we praying for enlargement? You know how many people can physically fit inside this sanctuary? 250. I've calculated it out. 250 people can sit in here. Do we have a vision for enlargement? Or are we just happy where we're at? God has called us to go out. In Acts chapter 4, verse 33, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. We need that. And we need it not for ourselves, but for those that we need to be reaching out to. Are we all doing what we can? No. And I know that I'm not doing all that I can. Not all that I want to do. Doing what I can while I can. But one of the things is, back in verse 14, afterwards he, Jesus, appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them with their unbelief and hard hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. We got a lot of unbelief. And it's not unbelief because we don't believe Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. It's unbelief that Jesus is working with us. That Jesus, that we can do all things through him. Because we don't believe that he strengthens us at all. We've been eating the wrong stuff. We've been listening to ourselves. We need to listen to God. And we need to be empowered and allow him to work through us in living our lives in the joy that he would have for us to live them. We need to do it. Because if we don't do it, then who will? But I guarantee you, God will get somebody else to do it. So why don't we? Don't have Jesus come in and upbraid us, reprimand us. I mean, that's the letters to the churches in Revelation now. I want us to be the church in Philippi. I want the love letter. I don't want all the others. However, well, what are we going to do? Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you for your word, even though in so many times it comes down and strikes hard on us. But Lord, we know that just like if we're hammering a piece of wood from the hard wood, we need to apply more force to get the nail to go through. Lord, may we be pliable. May we be the soft wood that hear and understand and receive and obey easily. Lord, we do not want the difficult correction. But Lord, if there's someone here who is still in need of salvation, that wonderful good news, the gospel of Christ, to have that salvation experience, to know that they're saved, truly saved. Maybe someone needs baptism, have received and have yet to obey you in baptism. Maybe someone's looking for a new church home. Whatever the situation, to come and Lord, to the altar and just ask for forgiveness and repentance. Whatever the need, you're here. We're here, Lord. And we just simply ask to have willing hearts to receive those who are still in need of searching. But whatever the reason, Lord, whatever the cause, we humbly place it before you. Your invitation is open, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we always ask everyone to stand, and we're going to turn to hymn number
573.
What's the Lord calling you to do today? What is he calling you? Why not answer? Why not obey as we sing?
I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. Take thy cross and follow me.